This video shows how to use component-based design for multi-instantiation of adaptive assembly, like the piers of a bridge along a curve, reusing same elements like foundation of the piers, and designing all piers in their local axis system, which can be useful if you want, for example, to automate drawing generation afterwards. Component-based design avoid creation of a script in EKL language and clarify the switch from a preliminary design to a detailed design because it's using a specific object called an object type that links an UDF to a PLM template. And the key thing to remember is that UDF and PLM template should use the same inputs and parameters with the same names. So you would start instantiating UDF inside the part, tune the parameter and inputs, and once the specification looks good, launch the automatic creation of the PLM object in the product structure. This is the scenario that we are going to replay now step by step. And we'll start by showing the settings to use. For example, you can use meters, but the important option to use is keep link with selected objects, and of course to display all the knowledge where in the tree. We'll start by creating the UDF. So I make a new part. Rename it. Rename also the 3D shape. Then create a geometrical set to put inputs. And create a new axis system that must be called base axis system. Now I design the curve that will represent the upper limit of the piers. And I create a geometrical set for the definition of the UDF. That's why it's called UDF definition. This is the most tricky part. You need to create a datum axis system with the formula to link it to the base axis system. Reorganize the tree by pushing the formula inside the geometrical set. Then create a parameter to drive the width of the pier and move this parameter inside the geometrical set. Create a point to define the pier elevation. Be careful to use only the second axis system. For example, to create a sketch now, select first the YZ plan of axis system 2 and then click on sketch icon. Create the front profile of the pier, dimension it, symmetry on Y, drive width with the parameter, pier foot coincidence on the X axis, and the coincidence of the upper side of the pier and the upper point. Create a surface to represent the pier with the color. Sort the tree, put elements in OSHO, and now create the UDF. Select features on the tree one by one from the bottom to the top, and the input should only be the curve and the axis system. Make sure that rename the curve, the spline in curve, and then rename the UDF and save the part. It's actually easier to save all the models that we're going to create now in a catalog, because then they are better organized. Now let's create the object type and link the UDF to it. Rename the object type. Indicate adaptive to explain that it should instantiate PLM templates. This is how you link the UDF to it. Save the object type and store it in the catalog. We'll use this object type now to instantiate the peer features. Before this, we need to create a product structure. So we create a peer product that can be renamed, for example, testing model. Add a part skeleton. Now rename it. Create necessary inputs for instantiation. So we'll make the curve on the ground for peer alignments. Now I make a low to drive the vertical elevation of the bridge. The elevation is made by using the sweep command and the log that was just created. Now, using boundary command, you can get the curve that will drive the peer elevation. Sort the tree and put elements in no-show. This joint operation now is a way to get a curve element out of a sketch. Now we can start multi-instantiation in feature mode. You select the type of the object type, so in this case it's peer. It launches a search to retrieve the object type that we just created. And now we're going to multi-instantiate it along the ground curve by selecting it. This tool here automates the creation of axis system along this curve by quantity and spacing. Then select the curve that relimits the peers in elevation and click on process, and it will build the peers feature. If one peer should have a specific width, it can be modified like this. For example, for the third peer, let's say 10 meters width. Save and store in CAD. Now reorganize the windows to keep the construction models on the left and the testing model on the right. Now we are going to design the detailed piers as an assembly. So we create a pier product. Rename it peer assembly generic, for example. Generic meaning that it is going to be used to define a PLM template. Insert a skeleton 3D shape and rename it. To make things easier, it's possible to reuse the geometrical set that was used in the UDF part, because the logic is the same. With a little difference, however, is that in the PLM template you don't need to define all your geometry based on the base axis system. So we retrieve the width parameter, but we can delete the geometrical set used for UDF definition. We need to recreate the points that defines the pier elevation, and we create an horizontal plane through this point. Now we create the foundation type part that will always be same on all piers. Rename it. Make a simple pad to represent this foundation. And set a color to it. Remember to put colors on body. It's the most stable way. You can fix the part position relatively to its parent product like this. And now we're going to make the adaptive pier of this assembly. It's a part of type pier. Draw the section of the pier driven by the width parameter. And then make a pad up to the upper plane. And then don't forget this important step, is that you need to define this product as a component. So you click on this icon that will generate a publication from the base axis system found in the 3D shape just below the product. You need to use this icon, because if you make the publication manually, it will not work the same. Then save this product and put it in the catalog. Let's make now the template from this pier assembly. So we create an engineering template object like this. Rename it. Select the peer assembly generic that we just created. Make sure the foundation part appears in the lower frame. It means it will only be reinstantiated, whereas product and 3D shapes in the upper frame will be duplicated as new. And then, as an input, you select spline 1 in the skeleton, and remember to rename this input exactly like in the UDF, so curve in this case. And for a parameter, you select the width attribute and again check that it's named exactly like in the UDF, so width, it's okay. Then save and store in the catalog again. Now link the peeling template to the object type, like this. And save. Now, I simply need to execute generation of the PLM peers by clicking on change level of development. This is going to reuse the specification at the feature level of the peer and instantiate the PLM template with the same specification. Because it is working at product level now, the generation is taking more time than at the feature level. But it's still so much faster than if you had to do it manually, especially if you have hundreds of elements to design, which is usually the case in the industry. I'm showing you now that you could decide to change the specification at feature level. For example, changing the third pile width and put it back to 5 meters, for example. And see how an update would recompute the detailed PLM peer, which would not necessarily be the case if I had used the EKL action with scripting for template instantiation.